Hey guys, Dr. J here, and in this video we're going to go over airport operations. These are going to be part of your Part 107 knowledge topics. And I think it's fair to say that some of these topics you're going to be like, why do I need to know this to know how to operate a drone? But the Part 107 exam actually has a number of questions on it which pertain to just general airport and airplane information. Things about airports, airport traffic patterns, things that are going to be related to safety for drone operators. And then there's going to be some things like airport signs that you're just going to be like, what in the world? Why do I have to learn this? But it's okay. It won't take that long. And it'll be on the Part 107 exam, and that'll be an easy question for you to answer. So let's jump right in. So types of airports. Airports are referring to any area on land or over water designated for takeoff and landing of aircraft. And so that's an airport. Now there are several major classes of airports, and the biggest class differentiation is going to be towered versus non-towered airports. So obviously, probably many of you have seen a control tower at an airport. These are going to be the towered airports. Towered airports are going to have air traffic control active at least some of the time, maybe not all the time, but at least some of the time there'll be people in the control tower that are going to be communicating with airplane pilots as they're coming in and out. And obviously pilots are required to communicate with air traffic control when it's there. There are going to be many, many airports around the country, at least in the United States, for which there is no control tower. So no air traffic control, no radio communication that's required. And there's many, many of these throughout the US, and I know throughout other countries as well. And in this case, you're going to be using other types of radio frequencies for keeping an eye on what's going on at that airport. So two common ones that I'm going to have you just kind of tuck away in your mind, and we're going to talk a lot more about these later, is the Common Traffic Advisory Frequency, or CTAF, or the Universal Integrated Community, UNICOM. These two acronyms, CTAF and UNICOM, you're going to see again. We're going to see those when we come to charts, and we're going to be talking about airports and how airports look on charts. So just keep that in mind. We'll see more about that later on. We can also divide airports into civilian, military, and private airports. And we'll see again, this is going to come up later when we're looking at charts, and we'll be able to distinguish and differentiate between military and private airports and regular civilian airports. Okay, so let's talk more about airports. And one of the concepts we need to talk about is runway orientation. And in order to understand this, we need to understand some basics of geodesy. And that is the difference between true north and magnetic north. So true north is the direction from where you are to the Earth's physical north pole. And when I say physical north pole, I mean the orbital axis of the Earth. So the Earth is rotating on its axis. The location where that rotation is happening, this point right here, is the true north pole of the Earth. Now, unfortunately, perhaps for us in this case, the magnetic north pole is not exactly the same or in the same location as the geographic north pole. The geographic north pole, and this is sort of shown in this little diagram here, where the black line is the geographic north and south pole. This is the rotation axis of the Earth. And the green line or the red line there, I can't actually tell which it is because I'm a little bit colorblind. So whichever one it looks to you, that is the orientation or a cartoon representation of the Earth's magnetic north and south pole. And you can see they're just a little bit off from each other. Now, actually, the magnetic north and south poles change their location through time, and there's some reasoning behind this. Here's a map just showing the location or modeled pole locations from 1590 to 2020. So you can see the pole was sort of moving around, has changed the direction a few times, and actually now is taken off at a rather quick pace, and is actually currently at a location fairly close to the geographic north pole. But that's not been the case for hundreds of years. Now, the reason behind why this happens has to do with what we think about the generation of the Earth's magnetic field, and these are coming from currents in the Earth's outer core. The Earth's outer core is liquid iron and nickel. So this is liquid metal moving around, generating the Earth's magnetic field, and as it's liquid, it can change through time, and so some of these changes are resulting in a change in the location of the Earth's magnetic pole. I would say we probably don't understand this topic as well as we would like, but the observation is that the location of the magnetic pole is changing. And so because of that, we're going to have a difference that we measure. We call that difference variation or magnetic declination. That's just going to be the difference between true north, the direction that you would point towards true north, and the direction that you point towards, that your compass points towards when it's pointing towards magnetic north. And the magnetic variation can be quite large and change depending on where you are and where you're going. So if you're flying, let's say, across the United States from east to west, you're going to start out with a declination to the west, 15 degrees west, 10 degrees west, 5 degrees west. Actually, here in Missouri, very close to where we are here at Missouri S&T, we are close to the agonic line, which is the location or the line where that line is pointing directly to both the Earth's magnetic and geographic poles. And of course, these lines are going to change through time as the Earth, location of the Earth's magnetic pole changes. And then as you go west, we have an east correction. Mathematically, this is how this looks. We have true north equals magnetic north plus the variation. Or true north minus the variation equals magnetic north, where west is negative. So this is how you would think about that. And the reason that all of this is going to matter for us is that all charts, airspace charts, are going to be based on true north. And they're going to show those isogonal lines. And you can just imagine, if you're navigating in an aircraft, you're going to want to know what these lines are as you're flying around, especially if you're on very long distance flight. However, even though charts are based on true north, runways are going to be identified with a two-digit number that refers to orientation based on magnetic north. So you can just imagine building a runway, you hold a compass up to your runway, and whichever direction that compass indicates that your runway is facing, you're going to give it that direction. So it's based on magnetic north. Orientation is measured 360 degrees from north. There's no 00 runway. It's going to be 36. 36 will be your runway, or 360, I should say. So 360 is north, 90 is east, 180 south, and 270 is west. Now, the way that this works in practice is that you just have a two-digit number. The first two digits, the last digit, is dropped. So we've got here 180 on top and 360 on the bottom, or the way that you would read this would be 36 and 18. And the runways are numbered based on the direction that you face as you take off and land. So if we were coming in our aircraft from the bottom, that would be facing the north, and so we're facing 360 degrees, and so that's runway 36. If we were coming in from the north, we would be facing south, and so our runway would be 18 for 180 degrees. How about this example? We've got runway 03, which is 30 degrees. That's going to be if we're coming in from the just east of south. And if we're coming in from just west of south. Just west of south. And if we're coming in from just east of north, we're going to get runway 221, which is for 210 degrees. All right, so should be fairly easy for you to pick up on these orientations. Here we have 09 for 90 and 27 for 270. Now, if we have multiple runways that are parallel to each other, these are designated with letters to distinguish them. So 36 left, 36 right, and then 36 left, 36 center, and 36 right would be here if you had three parallel runways. I think the largest group of parallel runways is four, but mostly you're going to see two and three parallel runways. If there are crosses on a runway, that designates the runway as closed. That means there's going to be no air traffic on that runway. Now, these air traffic patterns that we're going to talk about next are going to be very important for you to understand as a drone pilot, because if you're operating in or around an airport, you're going to want to know what planes are doing. And if you see a plane, you're going to want to be able to very quickly understand where that plane is going and what it's doing. If it's taking off, it's landing, where is it going to be? Where is it in the traffic pattern? And these traffic patterns are used by pilots to make an organized approach to landing, and of course by air traffic control as well. And these are going to be happening, these air traffic patterns around right around the airport will be between 0 and 1,000 feet above ground level, AGL. Okay, so let's talk about airport traffic patterns. Here is a very typical left-handed traffic pattern. Here we're on runway 09, and the airplanes are going to be taking off and landing from left to right, and then making all left-hand turns. So that's why we call this a left-handed traffic pattern. You're going to have airplanes entering here at this pattern entry point, and even if an airplane is coming from the opposite direction, it's still going to have to go all the way around and then enter the traffic pattern at this entry point. So you'll see If you've been flying before, you've probably noticed that as you start getting close to an airport, but you're still a little bit of ways away, the airplane might start making some curves and moving around, and that's because it's positioning itself to enter into the traffic pattern. So, few things here. What direction is the wind blowing based on this traffic pattern? Well, airplanes are going to be taking off and landing into the wind. So in this case, the wind is going to be blowing from right to left. What would happen if the wind changed to be from left to right? Well, in that case, our aircraft would start using runway 27 instead of runway 09 to take off and land from. So they would reverse their direction. By the way, I was in an airplane one time coming into San Francisco, and we were coming down, and it turned out that there was another airplane was too close to the airplane that I was in. And so actually, as the airplane was on its final approach, the other airplane got too close, and so the autopilot took over and actually took us off again. So we actually ended up going back around this traffic pattern and had to make another full circle because of that airplane being too close. So, and that's what happens. If you have a problem where you can't land, then this airplane comes back into the traffic pattern just following these left-hand turns in this case, or if it was landing from right to left, then it would be making right-hand turns. So here's a diagram of what this looks like. This is again a left-handed traffic pattern. Airplanes are coming in to the downwind leg, coming across the base leg, and coming into the final descent. If we have a right-hand traffic pattern, again, same general pattern, but opposite turns, so we're making all right-hand turns in this case, coming into the pattern on the downwind leg, making a right-hand turn into the base, and then a right-hand turn in our final descent. Okay. Now, what's going to help us understand which patterns are being used in each of these, in a particular airport? So we have these things called segmented circle, and these are going to be indicating our landing direction and the traffic pattern that we're going to be using. So in this case, we might have two runways. One of them is 0927, and that's going to be our east-west runway. You can see the wind indicator is saying that the wind is blowing from right to left, and so the runway that's going to be used here is runway 09, and the little tick marks on the ground, let me back up so you can see these, little tick marks here are indicating what direction the turns are that you're going to be making. So in this particular case, you're landing on runway 09, and you're making left-hand turns, so it's a left-hand traffic pattern. If we were to reverse the direction, and so you would be landing on runway 27, that is indicating we're still following our tick marks, and so that is indicating a right-hand traffic pattern. All the turns are right. How about for the north-south runway, 3618 or 1836? In this case, I don't have the wind correctly marked here, but basically if we were landing on runway 18, we would be, again, following these tick marks, we would be making right-handed turns, and so this is a right-handed traffic pattern. And if we were using runway 36, we'd be making all left-hand turns, and so this would be our left-handed traffic pattern. And so here's how we can use these wind indicators and traffic indicators to tell which direction, which traffic pattern we should be using if we were approaching an airport in an airplane. All right, so the next section is airport signs, and just a couple of signs that we need to be aware of. One is our taxi signs or taxiway signs. Letters are going to be used to denote taxiways. As you recall, we had two numbers for denoting runways, but any designation which is starting with a letter, Alpha 19, for example, that's going to be a taxiway. And here we're on taxiway Alpha 19, and we're coming up to taxiway Alpha. Here we have several different taxiways that are all coming together, and we can see how that it would be marked. The black background, by the way, is our current location. So remember, we are using two-digit numbers for runways, and of course we've got two runways for every one way because we have both directions, and so we have runway 0422 in this case, and we have taxiway A4 coming up to the right. So runways, or taxiways actually, that are marked in red means hold short. So at this sign, in fact, I think I've got a sign here, which shows how there's a hold short mark on the runway itself. This means you need to hold short before crossing, and that means that you're getting ATC authorization. You need to wait for air traffic control to authorize you to go past this mark if you're going to continue on. And this is, of course, to prevent airplanes from crashing into each other on the runways and taxiways at an airport. So the air traffic control will signal the plane when it's clear to go across the hold short position. And just a note, just a couple more signs here. Here is a taxiway D7, and you're coming up to runway 4 right, 22 left. And then finally, we have a do not enter sign. This just means do not enter. Easy to remember, and that's about it. One kind of topic related to signs is airport beacons. So these are going to identify airports at night, and there are specific patterns. You will want to memorize these for the Part 107 knowledge test. We have white and green, which is for civilian airports. White, white, and green is a military airport. White and yellow is a water airport, and white, yellow, and green is a heliport. So again, just pause the video, take a moment, memorize these, and that will get you through the Part 107 exam.